2005, a young 24-year-old man named Mark Capone was quickly rising through the ranks of WWE as Muhammad Hassan, an Arab-American character who quickly became the most hated heel in the company. And that's saying a lot, given that Edge was likely the top villain in WWE and a Hall of Famer. But Hassan's character got a lot of heat for remarks he made about discrimination and prejudice against Arab-Americans after 9/11. It was a pretty controversial take to do with the character, especially at that time. It all, unfortunately, came to a quick halt thanks to a poorly timed segment that turned disastrous. WWE decided in July of that year it would be a good idea to bluntly indicate that Hassan had brought in mass terroristic-looking thugs to assault The Undertaker in a scripted scene on SmackDown that was taped on July 4th. The problem with it: actual terrorist attacks hit London on July 7th, the same day that segment was set to air. WWE got a lot of reported heat from UPN, their broadcast partner at the time, and the immense pressure led to them canceling the Muhammad Hassan character altogether. He was sent packing to Ohio Valley Wrestling, WWE's developmental territory, after being written off at the Great American Bash pay-per-view in 2005. A deflated Mark Capone felt that he had missed a huge opportunity, and soon later called it quits with wrestling altogether. While it hasn't always been as controversial, many other stars have shared the same fate of a gimmick or character being put upon them that simply turned their careers in the wrong direction. Just ask the Shockmaster, who had one of the most botchamania infamous debuts in wrestling history for all of the wrong reasons. The Shockmaster, played by Fred Ottman, jumped ship from WWE in 1993 and was supposed to make a huge splash in WCW with Sting, Davey Boy Smith, and Dustin Rhodes in their War Games match against Sid Vicious, Vader, and Harlem Heat. At WCW's Clash of Champions 24, the man called Sting made the big reveal of his team's final partner, the secret power they had, a man wearing a stormtrooper mask. Yeah, everyone immediately knew how bad this was. It was hard for anybody to control their laughter, and somehow only Sid Vicious managed to stay in character the entire time, because he's the master and ruler of the world. Big men burdened in a tough role continue with King Mabel, the former man on a mission turned into a heavyweight bad guy who won the King of the Ring and briefly, we mean briefly, was WWE's top villain facing Kevin Nash for the WWE title at SummerSlam 95, and then subsequently got booed out of the building in Philadelphia. He even feuded with The Undertaker before his departure and would return to WWE only as a part of The Undertaker's Ministry of Darkness under the moniker of Viscera. He may have never been truly a top guy, but he filled a good role on the roster as a unique big man and returned yet again in 2004 and changed his name to the World's Largest Love Machine. Yeah, that was a character. As you can imagine, the storylines weren't great, and whether it was him trying to unsuccessfully seduce Trish Stratus and then Lillian Garcia, or being the muscle to Matt Stryker after changing his name to Big Daddy V, it was almost surprising that it took 4 years for his time in WWE to end for good. For Sean Stasiak, his gimmick change was the end of his wrestling career. The son of a wrestling legend and the fifth WWE champion in the history, Stan Stasiak, there were high hopes for this second generation star. He was unable to reach the level that was expected of him, and his first run in WWE saw him get fired after recording a real-life argument between Steve Blackman and Davey Boy Smith. Yeah, don't do that. He joined WCW in 2000 in its dying days and returned to WWE when his employer was bought out. Unsurprisingly, he played a minimal role in the entire invasion thing. He is truly remembered for getting humiliated every single time he tried to attack a WWE star, whether it was tripping over or running into an armored statue. He would miss and he would crash, and then people yell, "Botch on the internet!" Yeah. He later revealed in some interviews that he got heat because he unknowingly leaked the invasion angle when he was talking to a local radio station in Tampa, Florida. Yeah, that wasn't a good idea. And speaking of bad ideas, He, after the invasion angle ran its course, claimed he was coming from planet Stasiak. This is his new angle, a planet. It was an awful one, and it instantly got lost in the shuffle before he was released in 2002. That seemed to be the end of Stasiak's wrestling career, and he went on to become a successful chiropractor. Matt Bloom has found a lot of success over the years as the head coach of WWE's Performance Center, but his 2 years before his retirement are ones that maybe should be forgotten. Matt Bloom found decent success in WWE as Prince Albert and A-Train, winning the Intercontinental title at one point. But the pinnacle of his career was his 6-year run with New Japan Pro Wrestling, where he was able to show off the true extent of his abilities and crush everyone he faced. There was some hype when he returned to WWE in 2012, but his Lord Tensai gimmick wasn't well received, to say the least. It was rather surprising that this knockoff Great Muda Lord Tensai thing picked up a victory over John Cena just 13 days before the leader of the C-Nation defeated Brock Lesnar on pay-per-view. Did we mention that this was also 2 weeks after Cena headlined WrestleMania against The Rock? Yeah, it doesn't matter how much green mist you can spit, you're not getting out of this one. Lord Tensai's push didn't last that long, and it was just hard to take him seriously. By November of that very same year, he was losing to Santino Marella and getting called Fat Albert. But wait, that wasn't even the worst of it. He was fooled into wearing women's lingerie and having a dance-off with Brodus Clay. The iconic Tons of Fun tag team were formed as a last hurrah in his 16-year in-ring career. But hey, this guy now shapes an entire new generation of wrestlers, so I think he's done okay. Terry Taylor has also had a hand in developing superstars along with Matt Bloom, and he also had the same type of tough gimmick situation. Back in the rock and wrestling days of the 1980s, Terry Taylor was considered among the most talented young wrestlers in the United States, competing in the territory system, and at one time was considered the next Ric Flair. Taylor had a lot to offer to WWE when he signed with them in 1988. So what did Mr. McMahon and company do, deciding to turn this young, promising superstar into the Red Rooster, who wore red tights and a red jacket and had a red mohawk on his hair? Yeah. Even having the legendary Bobby the Brain Heenan at his side didn't help, and it actually made things worse. It was hard to ever take him seriously, and WWE fans let him know it. In every possible turn, he was nothing more than an enhancement talent to them. Even when he split from Heenan, the damage was done. His run ended in 1990. He spent the next decade going back and forth between WCW and WWE, with none of his stints lasting longer than really 2 years. His career never recovered from that, while Bruce Pritchard, knowing everything about the wrestling world at that level, claimed that Terry Taylor wasn't being punished for the Red Rooster. Perry Saturn was absolutely getting punished when he fell in love with a mop. Yes, you heard that right. After a decent year with the Radicals breaking big into WWE and jumping from WCW, Saturn would make the blunder that would change his career forever. During a match against an enhancement talent jobber wrestler Mike Bell, Perry Saturn's opponent made a bad mistake, leading up to him legitimately beating Bell down to a pulp. He couldn't control himself. His act of anger didn't sit well with the officials backstage, who made an example of him. While Saturn was regularly accompanied to the ring by Terry Reynolds, WWE decided to put that story in the back end as Saturn received head trauma from an attack by the Acolytes and fell in love with a mop. Yes, a mop. A cleaning device. Eventually, Terry Reynolds made Saturn choose between her or the mop. It's me or the mop, which you call Moppy? The mop has a name now. Somehow the gimmick got over and led to a face turn, but his momentum didn't last all that long before he ditched the mop. After that, things were never the same for Perry Saturn, and his rings were released in 2002 before having a brief stint in TNA and Japan. Oh wow, you watched the whole video. That's awesome. Why don't you hit the like button, get in the comments below, and tell us about some character changes that didn't work for you. Subscribe to Sportskeeda Wrestling for more content just like this.